Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zollo Tech, and today Apple released iOS 14.5 Beta 4. This is available to developers and soon to public beta testers. If you're not seeing it by now, be sure to look back for it. Usually a little bit later in the day or the following day, it will be released. Now, this particular update came in at 383.3 megabytes on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. It was about the same size on the other devices here, the 12.9 inch iPad Pro from 2020, iPhone 6S Plus, and the iPhone 11. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at the build number. But before we do that, Apple also released alongside this iPadOS 14.5 Beta 4, WatchOS 7.4 Beta 4, tvOS 14.5 Beta 4, and macOS Big Sur 11.3 Beta 4. So all of those betas are available to developers right now. If you're testing any of those, you can get them now. They launch at the same time around the world for everyone. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number. We'll go to Settings, then we'll go to General, and then About. And as you can see, the build number is 18E5178A. And this particular build, being that it's got the letter A at the end, means we're getting very close to a final version or a release candidate or GM version that's going to release to the developers first and then to the public. So we're getting very close to that, and I'll talk more about that a little bit later. Now, the first thing that's new is a modem update. So if you have an iPhone 12 Pro Max, for example, you'll have a modem update. Whether or not you are having connectivity issues or not, that should resolve some additional issues or just fix some things that people might have been experiencing. So far, it's been pretty good for me, but if it wasn't, hopefully it fixes it for you, and we'll know in a few days for sure. Now, the first thing you can actually see is if you go under Settings and then go under Software Updates, under automatic updates, it says download only. If I tap on this, you can see it says download new updates and install security updates. So you can turn off automatic updates and just install security updates, it looks like, for some reason. But if we go to beta 3 and go to the same thing, we'll go to software update, you can see that it's a little bit different. It says download iOS updates, install iOS updates. So this has changed a little bit. It's a notable change since maybe we'll be able to install just security updates, but not new updates. It's hard to say, but you can see that they've changed some of the wording there. And if I turn it on, it doesn't do anything different. It just flips a switch. So it's kind of interesting that they've done that. And if you turn it off, they both disappear. Now, the next thing is there's code within the automatic updates that may pertain to this as well. Thanks to my friend, Steve Mosier, code is hinting that it will notify you or allow you to delete a previously unapplied update before downloading the newest version. So maybe you're on iOS 14.2, you never updated and 14.5 comes out, but you already downloaded it. Well, to spare some room on your phone, it would delete the old one, give you the option, and then allow you to install the new one. There's no physical mention of this anywhere that I can find, but it looks to be in the code. So that's kind of interesting. Now within the code, there's something there that we can't yet see that Apple may add to everyone soon, or maybe 14.5, but in the code, if we go into Music and then we go to Browse, scroll all the way to the bottom, for example, tap on Charts. Under Charts in the future, it looks like there's going to be an option to explore music in over 100 cities from around the world. So there could be charts for that around the world where you might have top albums, maybe say in the United States versus Canada, maybe in France or England, and it may show 100 different countries where there's top albums. So that'll be interesting in the future. It's not here yet, but it looks like it's coming very soon. Now, something we can physically see within the Music app is if we go into our library and we select an album, for example, scroll down below the songs and you'll see the actual date of the album release, the number of songs and minutes, and then also the record album artist or the company they're associated with. So you can see that here. If I go to the same place on beta 3, it's a little bit different. So the record label may be there or whatever company they have, but on beta 3, it's just the number of songs and minutes. Here on the right with beta 4, we have the date of release as well as the record label or company associated with it. So it's just a little bit of a change, but it's nice that they keep adding additional metadata. Now, something they've brought back that was there before is if you scroll down when you're within your library on an album, it will say show complete album. If you tap on this, it will bring you to the album and all of the songs. In beta 3, which I have on the left, it's not there. So if I go back one, you'll see show complete album is there. It's not on beta 3. Now, also, when you're within an album and maybe you want to play the song next, we can swipe to the right and we have these new buttons, and they've changed the color of those buttons in this beta. So on the left is beta 3. You can see the play next icon is blue. It's now more of a purplish color or a lilac color. So they've just made that slight little change within Music. Now, as far as physical changes in this update, that looks to be about it so far. However, there's quite a few resolved issues, and they didn't mention anything in their notes, but there are some that we can see. So if I turn off the phone here and I put MagSafe back on the back, you'll see the animation has returned. So some people were concerned this was gone, but it was a bug. Many people reported it, and now it works properly. So the animation for charging your phone with MagSafe is back. A lot of people reported that in feedback, and they've now fixed it. So that's a good thing. Also, I've not seen any lag when closing apps, for example. So when you swipe up, I haven't seen that. I didn't see that with beta 3. I haven't seen it at all in beta 4. So hopefully that's gone. Most people have reported that green tint is fixed. Now, it may show up in a couple different places throughout the phone, but so far it looks like it's fixed. Also, when you're booting up, the Apple logo used to flash and then go away, and then it would come back on. That looks to be fixed as well, according to some people. And then also, one thing that was broken was handoff to HomePod. That's working again, as you can see here. Now, Apple explicitly says this is broken in the notes, but as you can see, if I bring it away and bring it back, and it comes back on the iPhone. So if you had that feature, it wasn't working, it's now working properly. So that's something they've brought back. And also, it's actually vibrating the phone quite a bit and seems to be very sensitive still. So maybe they'll tweak that a little bit more, but right now it's quite sensitive and shows up very easily like it used to. So that's been resolved. And then another thing is when you're listening to music and maybe you're using Shazam, for example, we'll see if we can bring that further away. We're using Shazam, for example, and you want to listen for a song. We'll go ahead and show you they've fixed this a little bit. So now we're listening for a song. I'll play a song. So when it hears a song, you tap on the song. Now it opens back in the Shazam app if you have that installed. Before, it wouldn't do that. So that's actually fixed now. And then if you bring this down, it says that it used the microphone recently for Shazam. So that's been resolved. Now, thankfully, with Beta 4, the Apple ID prompt has been resolved. Every time you rebooted your phone with Beta 3, it would ask you to update your Apple ID settings. You would have to put in your password again. I haven't seen that with Beta 4, so they fixed that. That was pretty annoying every time you wanted to reboot your phone, or maybe the battery didn't last and you had to recharge it, it would ask for that Apple ID to let you sign back in and get all of your account information synced again. So I'm glad that they've fixed that bug. When it comes to the iPad, for example, I haven't been able to find anything different new in it, but it should be pretty solid. It's been great with all of the betas for me, and performance has been great as well. So the overall performance on the iPad and the iPhone has actually been great for me on beta 3, but the iPad had bad battery life, but battery life on beta 3 on the iPhone was actually okay. So performance is great. No issues here. Haven't had any lag so far closing apps, and it feels nice and fast. And we'll take a look at the benchmarks in a little bit. But as far as the battery life goes, if we go down to battery, you'll see battery health currently is at 100% for me. And then if we go back and look at the last 10 days, it's actually been okay depending on the day. So this was on my phone for a couple weeks. And you'll see, well, as recent as yesterday, 1 hour and 45 minutes of screen on time, 3 hours and 36 minutes of screen off time. I only used about a quarter of the battery. So given about a quarter of the battery, getting about 8 to 10 hours of screen on time on this phone. Some people are seeing better, some are seeing worse, but in general, it seems to be okay. And I expect it to get better as we get closer to the final release. And speaking of the final release, this particular release is probably going to be the last one, I think, before the release candidate. And the reason for that is a lot of people are suspecting an Apple event being announced tomorrow for the 23rd. And if we do have an Apple event on the 23rd, we'll have this version usually released after that event. So we could see a release candidate maybe later this week. They've done that before, and then have it finally released next week. Although it's possible if there is no event, it could go a little bit longer. So Apple's been kind of erratic with that right now, and we don't really know exactly when they're pushing things out. So that's possible. We could see it later this week. We could see it next week. We thought we were on a 1 week schedule with beta 3 to beta 4, and it seemingly looked like we were on a 2 week schedule now. Now, if we do have an event on the 23rd, I would expect them to release iOS 14.5 on that day, usually after the event, if they continue to do what they've done for years. Now, as far as the overall benchmarks of this, let's go ahead and take a look at it. So I ran Geekbench 5 on this, and we'll go to the benchmarks. And on my iPhone 12 Pro Max, you can see I scored 1,603 for single core, 4,123 for multi-core. This is actually pretty good based on the history. It's not incredible, but you'll see here's March 5th versus March 2nd, and the single core score is better, the multi-core score is worse. So it just depends on what your device is doing. Usually after a day or two, it will improve in general, so it should be pretty good. Now on the left, I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2020, then the iPhone 6S Plus, and then the iPhone 12 Pro Max. I'll be running the iPhone 11 a little bit later since this currently has beta 3, just so I could find any differences on it. But this should give you a general idea from the oldest supported phone rather to the newest, what your scores should be about. These could improve over the next couple of days though, as it continues to finish doing processes in the background. So that's it with iOS 14.5 beta 4. If I find anything more, I'll let you know in a follow-up video later this week if we don't have another release. And if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.